You did. So what I'm going to do is that I'm going to introduce it again to you, starting with machine learning, because there's no harm in listening to it second time. And then I'll give you two examples from astronomy for applications of deep learning. Right, so if you have any short questions, you can ask them during my talk. If they're longer discussion kind of thing, we can do it at the end. But feel free to interrupt me. Right, so now that this work has been done with a lot of people, and then two of them, Kaushal and Kaustubh, are around here. You're going to be listening to a lot of stuff from them. Ashish is also here. Ashish Mahabal is somewhere here. And yes, so he gave a talk yesterday. Right, so then, as you might all have heard, here we are talking about trying in some manner to emulate the brain, meaning that our brain learns. And we want to try to teach a machine to learn. Now, you don't take a one-by-one analogy here. There's no one-to-one correspondence. You're not trying to make a model of the brain. You just get inspired by what happens there. So for example, if you look at the way a baby learns, so then slowly the baby would learn to recognize a few faces. And then if a stranger comes in, then they immediately burst out crying or laughing, depending upon what kind of baby they are. And then if they don't see a person for as short as 8 days or 10 days or a month, they can completely forget that person. The process of learning has got to start again. And then in the beginning it is approximate, but then later on you find that it becomes more and more accurate. Right, so another thing which I noticed in very young children is that if you show them a thing on TV, at one time, used to sing to them. Now you put on the video. And then there's a thing which is favorite all over the world, and which says wheels of the bus go round and round. Okay. So they keep looking at it, and then they're looking at it extremely intently. And then next day you put on the same thing, and they're again looking at it intently. And that goes on and on. And until one day they suddenly say they don't want to see it. Right, so what is happening there? Is that they're the process of learning. So they are looking at all the images and the brain keeps. So the brain, their brains are not seeing the image as we are seeing it. Okay, because the analytical apparatus is not ready. And the analytical apparatus becomes ready in the process of learning, meaning it's a sort of a recursive thing, where they learn a little bit, and in the process, the brain gets adjusted. And then that goes on and on. And until they have learned it fully. So what do you mean they have learned it fully? Is that they know exactly what is going to happen, sequence by sequence, word by word, site by site. At which point it suddenly becomes boring because they can recall it themselves. Right, so the process of deep learning is something like that, where you actually show people, show them an image, show the machine, show the software or implementation, or the hardware implementation and image. Okay, and then it tries to learn what are the characteristics of that image. And then it can't do that with one image, it needs many, many images. And then later on it might learn to recognize faces. Okay, so we want to define a sequence of a procedure by which we can get the machines to learn what we want them to learn to remember. And then on that basis, to be able to recognize things. So it can be an image. Which for you is the easiest to understand, or it could be any other kind of signal. So there can be an image and a spectrum. As you know, what is a spectrum? A spectrum is, so you've got a wavelength on one axis and intensity on the other axis, and you get a spectrum. Similarly, you can have a time series, okay, meaning that you're looking at a signal. You're looking at a signal, let's say, the intensity coming to you from a star. And then that intensity can keep changing. It can keep changing because of many things, because the star could be pulsating. Or you could have a binary star where one star goes behind the other, blocks it, and so the intensity goes down, 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 again goes up. Right? So this is called a time series. So you can have a spectrum, you can have a time series. And the situation there is that it is a one-dimensional data, because it's a data stream. Whereas an image is two-dimensional. But you could have multi-dimensional images where you can stack images together, etc. So depending upon what kind of an object you are trying to learn, to understand, to decipher, then the network can be quite different. Right? So I just want to run you through some elementary things, because these are another nice picture which sort of digitized the brain. So what we want to do is to go from the natural brain with all its synapses and then neurons, and then reproduce that here. But this was done in the early days. You really now just use the vocabulary a little bit, but no more than that. Right? So, and then you must have heard about the data in astronomy. So I'll say that why do we need things like deep learning? We need them because there is so much data, and the job which was done by astronomers over decades or centuries even can no longer be done, simply because our machines are so much more powerful. Because you could do certain things with the eyes, you could do certain things with the photographic plates, certain things with CCDs. But now you survey the sky and you can get hundreds of millions of objects. Right? So there is no way in which you can go and study these objects in the same manner that you did before. So you need to automatize the process. Right? So big data. Now, for example, Kaustubh, what did you work on yesterday? What did you do yesterday? But did you talk about the surveys?
No.
All right. Right, so here, I'm going to talk very briefly about it. So this is called a slow digital sky survey. So what it does is that, what you do with a survey is that you take an image or a spectra of objects or a certain part of the sky. So there are two ways in which astronomers can do their thing. One is that they can pick certain objects because they're easily approachable, or they're easily observable, or because they're objects of interest, or whatever, and then you can observe them. And then you've got the data. On the other hand, you decide that this is a very slow process. And what I would like to do is to go and take an image of a portion of the sky. I mean, ideally, it should be the whole sky. But that clearly cannot be done by a single telescope, because a given telescope can either have access only to one half of the sky. Right? So let's say you observe the whole sky. I will show that to you in a moment. And then the Sloan Digital Sky Survey, so they observed one quarter of the sky. So they used a telescope which is about 2 meters in diameter at the Aperture Point Observatory, and then they had a mosaic of CCDs. So a given CCD is quite small, and so what you do is that you can put a mosaic so that you get a certain area of the sky. And what you do is that, in effect, you point to a part of the sky, and for 1 minute, 2 minutes, 5 minutes, whatever you have chosen, and then you shift it and again point it, shift and again point it. And that way you could, in principle, cover the whole sky. But this camera, the Sloan camera, works slightly differently. What they do is that, rather than stopping and then again this kind of jerky motion, it just goes on scanning the sky at a certain uniform rate. And as it scans the sky, electronically, you just move the CCD at the pixels down like this. So you get that idea? Just imagine that you've got a CCD, and then you're getting your images there. And now as you move the telescope, you also move the CCD inside electronically, so that each image, each pixel, gets exposed to the same part of the sky for something like 59.4 seconds. So that is the exposure. And you do it in 5 different filters. Okay, meaning that you've got these astronomical filters, and you've got 5 of them, and you observe them. And then you go on doing it. Now they've been doing it for about 20 years, and then they observe the sky. Another kind of survey is what is called a synoptic survey, where you observe the sky like that, and then after 1 hour, you go back there and again observe it. Then after 1 day, you come back. After 5 days, you come back. After a month, you come back. Because then what happens is that you can look at the image of the sky as it was at, say, 11 in the evening, and then at midnight. And you can see if there's a change between them. Right? So that is called a synoptic survey, where you are getting images of the sky as a function of the time. Right? So when you have observed with the Sloan, in DR14, there is data release 14. The data keeps getting released periodically. Now you are at data release 16. I forgot to update this. So it has got 933 million objects. I mean, that's a very large number, billion objects. Okay, and then out of which 260 million are stars, and then 208 million galaxies and 4.1 million spectra. Right? So how do you ever analyze this, right? Because how do you find them? And so you need verified databases, you need all these access engines, and then you can say that, show me the galaxy M31, which is the Andromeda Nebula. Or you can say, show me all the galaxies which are at a certain point in a small circle about a certain area of the sky. Right? And it immediately shows you the images which can download them. And you don't need a club membership for that, you don't need to pay any fees, nothing. All that you need to do is just in your Google search engine or whatever search engine you use, just type Sloan Digital Sky Survey and you get access to the whole thing. It's all completely free. There are also catalogs, meaning that they've got digital pipelines which actually go through these, they just scan the images and they'll make a catalog of all the stars, all the galaxies. So you can say that, tell me how many stars there are, or give me stars which are brighter than a certain magnitude, which are in this particular part of the sky. Okay, and which have been observed in the blue filter. And it just gives you those immediately. So that's called a catalog. Right, so now here, just to show you a modern one, a modern survey, which is called the Hyper Supreme Cam Survey. So this is on, there is a Japanese telescope called Subaru, and it is it's located in Hawaii. It has got a diameter of 8.2 meters, the image, the mirror diameter. And now they had a Supreme Cam, and now they have got a Hyper Supreme Cam. So why have I chosen out of these all surveys? Because Kaustubh and team, we have been actually creating a distributed database for their data. Okay, so we are familiar with it. And then you see that it has got a CCD, which is pretty large, which is a 2K by 4K CCD. Okay, so that gives you 8 megapixels. But there are 116 of them. Right, so therefore you get 870 megapixels. Just imagine how much data there is, and which covers 1.8 square degree of the sky. Right, these colors are all changed because I'm on a different machine now. Okay, so, and then you carry out this survey, and there's a huge camera for that. And then we see that there are the data which was released on May 30, 2019. So in some of you who would go to astronomical projects or PhDs can easily access this data and work with it. So now what happens is that, why, if the SDSS has already done the job, why do you need a new one to do it? Okay, so you look at it this way. This is an image of the sky in this galaxy. You can see the galaxies here. And then you see that this is with the bigger aperture telescope and a longer exposure. So you get a deeper image. You can particularly see it here. You see that this is the galaxy, and then you see this galaxy here looks like this. Right? So so that is the advantage of going to a bigger telescope. Then in a few more years, you'll have another survey called the Large Synoptic Sky Survey, LSST. This whole setup has been recently named as the Vera Rubin Observatory. Vera Rubin was a very famous astronomer who died some years ago, and it has been named after her. So you see that this is again an 8.4 meter telescope, like the Subaru, and then it's a synoptic survey, meaning it gets the sky again and again. And then it has got, you see that it produces 3.2 gigapixels for every exposure. So the amount of data becomes extremely large, and all kinds of interesting projects can be done with it. And it will produce 15 terabytes of data per night. Now this may seem very simple because after all, you can get a small disk, takes 1 terabyte. But just try to copy 15 terabytes from one device to another, and you know how difficult it is, okay? It takes forever. Right, so this is the GMRT, which is the Giant Meter Wave Radio Telescope near Pune, belongs to the Tata Institute of Fundamental Research. It's a radio telescope, and then, they also produce a lot of data. They also have got surveys, but all in the radio domain. Right, so now if you give me these data sets, how does one use it? So it's quite easy to imagine it in astronomy because I want to study galaxies, I want to study the morphology, I want to study the spectra. But in general, if I give you a large data set, what are the kind of things that you could do with it, okay, you should want to do. So it's a very large data set. And then if I studied all these galaxies, they all look very pretty and nice, but that is not what you are after. What you are after is to study, understand their physics, understand their astrophysics. So you want to know, for example, is a more luminous galaxy bluer or redder? Does it have certain kind of spectrum? What kind of stellar populations it has? How will the galaxy change with time? These are the kind of questions that you want to ask. And then you do that by classifying the galaxies into different types, by finding correlations in the data, by trying to find unusual galaxies. Because the same kind of galaxy, you got 100 million of them, there's no fun in that. What you're trying to see is that amongst those 100 million galaxies, are there at least a handful of galaxies which are completely different and which will give you a different idea of the astrophysics which is involved. Right? So what do you need for that? You need the domain knowledge, meaning that you need to know astronomy, you need to know biology, you need to know whatever it is that you're doing very well. And then you need a lot of mathematics and you need a lot of statistics. Okay, so that does not mean that these tools cannot be used by people who are not familiar with these things. Because, yeah? Somebody said something? No. I thought somebody said, sir, yeah. All right. So you need mathematics, you need statistics, but then there are all the packages available which you can apply, even though you may not be a mathematician or a statistician. Right, so that is the beauty of all the modern processing data analytics tools, is that you can apply them without knowing all the details. But the details of what, you may skip knowing the details about the way it works internally. But you really need to know the details about the applications. Otherwise, the results that you get could be completely wrong. And if you make any predictions based on those, or if you take actions based on those, then you may not be remain a very happy person, okay, because things could go badly wrong. And then you need visualization, you need data mining. And today, you have learned a lot about this from Kaustubh and Kaushal today, but what I'm going to concentrate on is the machine learning part. Right? So how does one apply machine learning to study images? Right, so what do you generally do with machine learning? You're familiar with, some of you at least will be familiar with this. And then you could, for example, do autonomous driving. Right, so you just send a car out with no driver. Just like there is no free lunch, it is not true that there is no driver. Somebody is, after all, taking the decisions, get the car, is going along the road, and you suddenly see a buffalo in front of you, what do you do? Or there's another car which is coming, another car is going. And then you need to constantly look at the scene. Right, so just if you've got an autonomously driven car, there'll be cameras in it. And the cameras will be taking images. And so you need to recognize the images, right? So what is happening? There are people there are cars, there are buffaloes, cows, bicycles. You need to recognize the image, and then you need to do it extremely fast. Because just imagine a motorcycle which is hurtling through. It's going to reach you in seconds, right? So you have to recognize it extremely fast and take immediate corrective action for it. So you need image recognition. For different kinds of things, you've got facial recognition. And then you need speech recognition. These are not all for autonomous driving, but different applications. So then you can say that the most rudimentary of all these things is optical character recognition. You know that there's this famous set of numbers, 1, 0 to 9, and then they have been written in different ways. And you have to teach a machine to learn to recognize those numbers. Now this can appear to be a very simple task, but it takes a long time. And then in this domain, you use these standard data sets for that. Then you use a standard data set, not because other people can't make other data sets, because you need to compare your results with what you did before and what someone else did before. So if I devise a new architecture for deep learning, then I would like to say that this works 50 times faster than what was used before. But 50 times faster for what? For a standard task. Then of course you'll go to other tasks and do it, because you need the standardization. And therefore, you'll find that there are these simple data sets which are there and which have been used for a long time. Right. So when you've got to think like machine learning, what is the general schema that you've got? So you see that, imagine that I want to recognize those integers which are there. And then what I will what I have is a lot of integers which are labeled. I mean, I know this is 0, I know this is 1, this is 2, like that. Right? So I'll have data with labels. I could have faces, for example, and then I could label them in some way. Now, in the old days, they actually built the machine learning hardware. Right? So it used to be, there used to be very big things and with lots of, and those were the days of walls, etc. And so you used to have very large machines doing very simple tasks. Now it is entirely in the software. And you can have the hardware thing, you can have it coded on the chip, but mainly you'll be doing the software. Right? So you've got a machine learning algorithm which is working, and then you show this algorithm your data and say, this is this, this is this, this is a dog, 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 cat, 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 like that. So you're giving it labeled data, and then the algorithm trains itself to recognize this. Right? So now, this is called supervised thing, because I'm giving it data and I'm telling it what it is. Now there's every possible variation on this, meaning you've got unsupervised learning, semi-supervised learning, all sorts of things are there. So whenever I tell you today that a certain thing is done in a certain way, it means that that is just one of the many ways possible. Okay, so just like in astronomy, you get up in the morning and you get all the preprints of the work done yesterday, there are lots and lots of these algorithms being developed every day, right? So you just stick to something, do it for a little while, then you change. So then once you've got the trained model, then there'll be test data. So what I'll do is that I'll give you a piece of paper and say, write any integer that you want on this, or any 100 integers that you want on this. And then we try to see whether the trained algorithm can recognize, that the trained model can actually recognize these integers. And then you see, it recognizes 99% correctly. Then you say that the accuracy is 99%. Right? So it can be 70%, it can be 80%. And then you have to improve your data, and then you have to fine-tune your machine, or you have to develop a new architecture until you get the result that you want. Right? So again, you have to go in circles here, meaning that you start with the data set, start with the algorithm, train the model, see whether it is doing well enough. And then if it is not doing well enough, you go back then. Right? So that's a very complex process which has to be followed. Right? So now, I'll go through a set of very simple learning tasks, and all of which are obvious. But then the solution is obvious. But the question is, can you train a machine to do it? And what is the implication of the training? Right? Meaning that if I train the machine, what have I done? Have I done something new, or am I doing something which I've been doing in the past and giving it a new name? Is it going to bring some further convenience and some further insight into the process of learning here? Right, so let us say that I got these two sets of points, and then these are blue and these are red points. Now the colors and the shapes have no significance. The only significance is these coordinates here. Right, so if I give you a x1 and x2 coordinates, then you know where the point is. And these are two, they're clearly two groups of points. And then it's completely trivial for you to draw a straight line like this and say, if you give me a new point, and then if the coordinates are certain things, to the left of the line, other to the right of the line. Okay, so now, so I have drawn the line. And how do I define the line? I define it here by giving you the equation of the line, w dot x is equal to 0. Right, so w1, it is like y is equal to a plus bx. So you've got two things there. Right, so this is the same one. w1 x1 plus w2 x2 is equal to w3. Whatever, you can write down these equations here. So I can, if I give you the two group of points, and then you'll say that you will define the straight line for me, right? And then how will I, if you give me a new point, what will the new point be? x1, x2. But remember that I got the vector w. So I just take w dot x. If it is greater than 0, it's to the right of the line. Less than 0, it's to the left of the line. Is that clear to you? Now how will I put this line? So if w dot x is greater than 0, it is right, otherwise it is left. Right, so how would I put this line here? Is that I just draw the line, and then I say, no, there's some blue points are to the left. I just move the line and rotate the line slightly. And very quickly, you will get the correct line. Right, so now just complicate this a little bit. Imagine that I got an n-dimensional space instead of a two-dimensional space. So I got x1, x2, xn. And then I can again put it. So what it means is that you can say that this is a neuron. A neuron is the basic unit in the brain. And then you've got these inputs coming in with these weights. Right? And what I want to do is that I want to arrange the weights in such a way that the points get classified into two groups. Right? So if I take the sum w dot x, if it is greater than 0, output should be 1. If it is less than 0, output is minus 1. And how do I do that? I need a process for it. Because here, I'm not going to apply my brain to it. I need an algorithm for it. So what you do is that, when I give you all these different points, x1, x2, x3, x4, etc., you just start with arbitrary weights, okay? And then you classify the points. So what does it mean? Is that, you see that I can draw the line here. Then I'll find that some points are to the left, which should be to the right. Right, so then, therefore the line is not correct. So what I can do is that I start with arbitrary weights, test for all the points, see how many points I got wrong and see how many points I got right, and then I keep moving the line until I get all points right. Right, so that is, you follow a particular thing for it. So you define what is called a loss function, and where the actual coordinates of the point, and then the coordinates that you're obtaining for the line that you have taken, and then you minimize this. Right, so there are algorithms for minimizing it until you get the line. Right, so you see that here we have done it actually. We have taken two groups of points, and then we have taught a software program to actually draw the line correctly. Right, so now supposing I got three groups of points, then what do I do? Now, there is no single line, which is going to be able to separate them. You get that? But the single neuron that I had got can only draw one line. Because a single neuron will give you only one equation, w dot x is equal to 0. So then how do I generalize it? First of all, x1, x2, I can have n input neurons here, input layers. And then now I got two neurons here. And each one of the input layers goes and talks to each one of them. And then this gives me the output. Because if there are three dimensions which are coming in, I need three weights, W1, W2, W3, and these are the outputs here. Right, so then you see that I can draw these two lines. So in the first way, the two groups I had one line, with three groups I got two lines. Right, now look at this one. How will you do it if I asked you to solve this problem? Can I draw lines to actually separate the two things? It turns out that you can draw the line because I can take one line. Right, so then it will become a very complicated network. On the other hand, let us say that why not I separate it by drawing a curve through the points? Right, so I take this one, I just draw a curve like this here, separate it there. But then, what is the equation of the curve? Because when I gave you a linearly separable points, you know what the equation of a straight line. But I can make it very complicated here and got a very complicated curve. And what is the equation of the curve? Now, in the old style of solving, in the classical style of solving problems, that is the way you do. You take a model line, a parabola, hyperbola, combination of these things, and then you try to minimize the loss function. It becomes a non-linear problem. What you do in machine learning is that you don't have to actually get the equation of the line. What you do is that you just take these points, x1, x2, etc., and then you train the thing. You say, if x1 and x2 is here, it is red, otherwise it is blue. But then you remember that you need to bring in non-linearity. And you bring in non-linearity, you have, first of all, you see that you have got the two inputs, you've got these hidden layers, and then you've got the output, right? And then what you do is that the thing from each layer, the signal from each layer is now nonlinear. Okay, so it is, for example, what is called a sigmoid function which goes this way, or it can be a very simple nonlinearity where the function is 0 up to a certain point and 1 afterwards. Right, so this is called a ReLU function. So now what we have done now is, first of all, we have got a hidden layer as before, but we have introduced nonlinearity. And when you do that, you see that you actually get the separation. Does it mean that when I taught this software network, the MIND software, to get that line, does it give me the equation of the line? It doesn't give me the equation of the line. It's just trained and it's waiting there. Right? So then, if I now give it a point, let us suppose that I give it a point here, it'll have x1, x2, it'll come and tell me that the thing is greater than 0. So it is on that side, this side of the line, or that side of the line. So I neither need the equation of the surface as an input, as a model input, nor is the trained network ever going to give me the equation of the surface. But what it is going to do is that it is trained, and if I give it a test point, it can tell me whether it is on that side or it is on this side. So these are very important points about this learning that you need to understand. Right? So these are done by Kaushal again. You see that we are trying out various functions. Because the number of neurons can be changed, the number of hidden layers can be changed, everything can be changed. And then we see that it goes on, and for different combinations, you see that you get different kinds of lines. Okay, so here, you have to be slightly cautious. But if you look at the points which are mixed up this way, and I want to separate them, I could really go and do an infinitely complicated line like this. But typically, that will not give the correct physics. And what you're doing is that each point, just imagine a straight line, and there are points scattered on the straight line. And why they're scattered? Because of the error of measurement. But instead of treating it as an error of measurement, I can just pass a curve through each point. And that is known as overfitting, which you don't want to do. So you have to have your head on your shoulders, and you have to say that what is it that I'm trying to look at? What is it that I'm trying to classify? And what would be the simplest model that I adopt to do the classification successfully? Right? So all of which requires you to understand the domain, and it also needs you to be proficient in what you are doing, and you need to have a lot of experience to do it. Okay, so typically what happens is that when project students come to work with us, they'll say in 2 days, they'll say, yeah, we know how to do it. We know everything about deep learning. What they mean by that is they can take a test program and they can just pass test data through it and get the test answers. The fact that you can run the program without it crashing does not mean that you know what you're doing. And so it takes a long time. Just like it takes you a lot of time to train the program, it also takes a lot of time to train yourself. And the best way to begin the process of training is to sit and read a book. Because there are really, really good books on these things. There are two kinds of books that you'll find. One will be these short little things that you can find on the internet. Right? They have their own role to play. But then there are these big books which are extremely well written by great experts. And then you have to make a proper combination of the two. And there are no shortcuts. Right, so now let's just imagine that I go and make a layer. Yeah?
So every time the algorithm gives the same answer?
It is like, just try to imagine you're trying to fit a surface to data. So what you're doing is that you're minimizing a function. Right? When you minimize the function, supposing that your surface is such that there is a global minimum, then whichever way you start, you'll always fall into that minimum. But you can have a situation where you've got close lying minimum, right? And they're all very similar. So then you'll get different solutions. So it depends upon the detailed distribution of the data. Right? So again, you have to test out for those things also. Am I getting the right answer? Which is in any minimization problem, what you do is that you'd first get an answer, then you'd perturb your starting conditions, for example, and then try to get another answer. And then if you get the same answer again and again, you are very happy. If you don't, you have to learn to live with it. And sometimes it is trivially true there, because that line, it could be this way, that way, that way. Yeah. Right? So it's dictated by the data. So you see that as the problems become more complex, your networks become more complex. And when the networks become more complex, you see that there are the weights which you're bringing in, W1, W2, et cetera, et cetera. Now, each one of the lines, each one of the connections that you see will correspond to one weight. Okay, so here, for example, there'll be a weight W1 going here. Then there are another weight going here, like that. So if you count the number of weights, then it become pretty large. Now, the thing that you have to do, you have to remember, is that the number of weights should be much much fewer than the number of data points. Otherwise, what happens is that if you have a very large number of weights and very small number of data points, then you can overfit, meaning that you are taking a curve which goes through each point, and then that's all. So if you bring in a new point, it will not be a good predictor of a new data. Right, so but then these things become unmanageable because you can have, we were counting weights in a problem that we are doing right now, a couple of days before we came here, and then you found that there's some 93 million weights. So if you got 93 million weights, you can say that you are trying to minimize a function which has got 93 million variables in it. Now that kind of a thing cannot be done. Meaning, first of all, you need very large computing power, and then the answers that you get cannot be trusted, and there'll be no insights available. So machine learning has, over the last 50 years or so, first they considered the very simple problem I told you, divided into two parts. Then somebody went and made a theorem saying that you cannot do that properly. Because there are a lot of deep, simple to read, but very difficult to prove theorems there, okay, which are involved. And then all the theorems tell you that you cannot do anything useful. Then you have to find a new technique. Right, so here, as the thing becomes more and more complex, and then you've got a lot of computing to do, which you cannot at any point, then you need to develop a new kind of approach. Right, so that approach comes out of deep learning. Right, where the artificial neural networks, now the deep learning networks work directly on the data, extracting useful features from the data. Now this is the most important part, work directly on the data. What do you mean by that? Is when you've got consider a simple problem where I want to distinguish between objects which are round and objects which are square. Now what I can do is that, or let's say to give a real life example, real astronomical example, I want to distinguish between stars and galaxies. Now a star is typically a point object, but because of the spreading of the atmosphere, it acquires a structure, which is like a two-dimensional Gaussian function. Right? And a galaxy is something very gorgeous. Right? There's a disk, there's spiral arms, all kinds of beauties are there. But then imagine taking the galaxy further and further away, and until it becomes smaller and smaller, and it becomes almost a point. At that point, can I say, is this a star or is it a galaxy? So if it is so far that it is completely unresolved, I can never say what it is. But we are talking about galaxies which are very far, but which we hope to resolve. We say that, all right, I'm very interested in knowing whether this is a galaxy or a star. So how do I do it? What I can do is that I can take a point source has, in some approximation, a two-dimensional Gaussian surface, whereas the galaxy will not be Gaussian. So I can look at the images, I can define some parameters for those images, and then learn a lot of those parameters and say, this is a galaxy, this is a star. But that is what is called machine learning, because I'm looking at objects which I want to classify, then I'm defining some attributes of these objects. And these attributes, you can treat them as our coordinates x1, x2, xn. And then based on the values of these attributes, I say this is a galaxy or this is a star. Right? But now, when you go to deep learning, they work directly on the data. Meaning what? You just give it the image of a galaxy, and you give it the image of some other kind of object. And you say, this is a galaxy, galaxy, galaxy. Right? This is star, star, star. And then the algorithm looks at the image, and it decides how it is going to actually study the image, what filters it is going to apply, and on that basis, it does the classification. So what do you mean by that? Is when I'm looking at your faces, my brain is analyzing your face on the basis of my previous experience with faces. Right? So there are a certain number of filters in my brain. And then when I look at a face, I can pick off all the horizontal surfaces, the vertical surfaces, the edges, the rounding. And here I can also pick up the color, for example. Right? So these are all properties of the face. And then my brain is looking at those properties. And then it breaks them up into a certain number of things to study and compares them with the data bank which is there. And then, yes, this is my friend Ramesh. But that happens instantaneously. Right? But if you don't know the identity, even then, you can say, I've seen this person somewhere. And when at airports, it happens to you all the time. You've seen a person somewhere, either fleetingly, or you have known that person well many years ago. But their data has become blurred. Okay, and the labels also have got blurred. So you really don't know who that is. Right? But how do I recognize the person? Is that on the basis of a number of filters that my brain is applying to analyze the face, okay, and the appropriate filters. So for example, let's say that I give you patterns of lines, vertical lines. Okay, and some are close by, some are far. And I need to classify those lines, and I'm looking at it. Then if I apply horizontal filters, I'll get zilch, right? If I take a horizontal filter, it's not going to make any difference. But if I take a vertical filter and move it, then I'll get different patterns in that filter. Right? So the filters have got to be designed, okay, to suit the data. So what a deep learning network, particularly a convolutional neural network does, is that it looks at the image, and then it chooses, you tell it that you can use 64 filters. Okay, and this filter should be of this size. That is all, you don't tell it which filters to use. And then it creates these filters and runs them across the images. And the idea will be that you take the filters across, that is like smoothing the image, so that the data becomes less. And then it picks out the most important data patterns from that. And then again it applies a different filter. And it goes on doing that. And in each step, the total amount of data which is used to define the patterns in the image keeps decreasing. So that is the most important thing, is that you are carrying out a set of operations which decrease the dimensionality of that image. Okay, meaning that, imagine that I got a CCD image with 1K by 1K pixels. So how many pixels is that? This is just 1 megapixel. 10 to the 3 into 10 to the 3, that is 10 to the 6. Right, so now, what I could have in principle done is treated each pixel as separate and given the 1 million inputs to a function. And then those 1 million inputs I could learn to classify. But then if I take this pixel and move it there, I'll get the same result because I'm treating each pixel as independent. But when I'm applying convolutional filters, I can't move the eye from there to there. I can't move the eyebrow from there to there. Because the eyebrow is in its place, the nose in its place, the mouth is in its place, and the interrelated pixels. And that allows me to reduce the dimensionality of the data. Okay, so when I reduce the dimensionality of the data, once it is handleable, then I can apply my machine learning techniques to classify it. Right, so you see, there is a thing here where there's the image of a dog, and then it is passed through. You look at the edges, then the curves which are there, and it has even gone into textures, it has gone into appearances. Right? So here you have got the low-level information, meaning that straight lines, edges, circles, low-level information. And that is being analyzed now to give you the high-level classification. That this is a dog. So you start from there, you reduce the dimensionality of the data, and then you apply the classification technique. Right? So for example, how do you do this here? So you've got a car coming in, and then the possibilities are that is a car, a truck, an airplane, a ship, or a horse. Right? So you see that then it is being broken up. Each one of these filters is isolating different features of the cars, and then it has been trained. Now, once you show it the image of a car, what does it do? It shows you, it breaks it up into the five possibilities, and it says a car with so much probability and a horse with so much probability. And typically, you pick the highest probability label. So you get that? So the important thing is that you are using the whole data. You are simplifying the data by using filters and other such devices. And then the lower dimensional data is being used in the classification. Now, when you actually do it in practice, there are different kinds of networks that you've got. And then, so you see that one layer, two layer, three layer, it can get very complicated. And this, we use this in the application which I'll just show you. So 12 layers with 5 convolutional layers. There are all kinds of things that you can do here. You shouldn't underdo, you shouldn't overdo. Right, so now I'm going to give you, how much time more? Anybody counting? About 15 minutes more. Yeah, 15 minutes.
Is primarily used to reduce the dimensionality of the image or the full image. After that, we actually do our training algorithm.
Yeah, that's right. The whole thing is training. The whole thing is training. It's not pre-processing. Okay, so you cannot separate out one from the other, but there are different layers doing this. Different layers carry out different functions. They could come one after the other, and you can say that I want 5 convolution layers, 100 convolution layers, depending upon how complex the image is, right? And then how many you should apply depends upon the experience that you've got. No, not the experience you've got, it depends upon the kind of results that you're getting out of. Okay, so for example, in machine learning, there's nothing which tells me that for this data, I require 2 hidden layers and with 7 in each. I could have 1 hidden layer, I can have 3 hidden layers. The idea is to work with the simplest possible architecture. And if it does not work, then you make it a little bit more complicated. And the whole thing is to not overdo what you are doing. Yeah, please? Yes. Absolutely, absolutely. That's a very good question. Both these questions are very good. And then, you see, for example, you could have a dog, okay, with one leg tucked under it, okay, so three-legged dog. So you have to be able to see that it's a dog. And secondly, it may be looking this way, it may be looking that way, there could be more light, less light. It could be on the floor like this, it could be in a patch of grass. Right, and then there could be birds flying across. So it is looking at the whole thing. Yes, everything. Right, in astronomy, the background would be the noise. Right, the noise in the sky, which you see. The sky is the background, and then the images are there. Yeah. No, what it is doing is that it is just looking at the image, right? So I could take a very low resolution image of a large area of the sky, and there are only 1,000 by 1,000 pixels, but I use a very, very ultra wide angle view, and it's covering quarter of the sky completely. Or I could be using a very large CCD with very high resolution to look at a very small part of the sky, right? So it is scale invariant. Meaning it won't say that, but the thing is that for deep learning, you require enough data. So if you just take 16 by 16 images, then you don't need deep learning like that. Okay, but once the data is there, it is scale invariant. But what will happen is that if you use low resolution data for the training, and then it can't recognize high resolution data on that basis. So what you want to, what you use for the training must depend upon what is your application. Yeah? No, that's what I told you, is that there is no fundamental theory which tells you what should be the number of layers, right? So for example, just to give you an analogy, if I got, say, I told you that I got points along the straight line, and it's perfectly along the straight line, you can immediately guess what the equation is, right? But if the noise, the points will be scattered along the straight line. Now I can take the attitude that, look, this is actually a straight line, there are only two parameters in it, and look at the scatter around that line. Or I can say that, no, here the pattern is going this way, so I can attach, I can just curve the thing a little bit. So it'll become a more complicated equation. So typically, let's say that I got 10 points, and I can use a first degree polynomial, which is just a straight line, or I can use a second degree polynomial like a parabola, or I can use a 10th degree polynomial. If I do that, I'll have 10 independent coefficients. So I got 10 points. So I'll get 10 equations for 10th unknown, so I can solve them completely. Then the line will go through each point. And so I overfitted the problem. Then, but there is nothing to tell me to not do it. So you could have taken a 10th degree polynomial and then given me those points, and like an idiot, I put a straight line to it. But then what will tell me that what I'm doing is not right is that the loss function, meaning that if I evaluate the chi-square probability, then I'll say that the chi-square probability is not coming good enough. So this is not really a straight line, like that, okay? But there's nothing which will allow me to uniquely say that it's a 10th degree polynomial. So like that now, when you generalize this concept to the architecture of machine learning, there's nothing to tell you how many nodes here, how many nodes there, but it is basically understanding of the problem and the requirement of simplicity. You don't want to make the solution too complicated. Right, and then it comes out of experience. There are, of course, lot of different theorems which guide you through the whole process. Yeah? You remember that you are not defining the filters, right? We are not telling it that you take 3 filters of this type, 5 filters of that type. Okay, so what we are doing is that we are simply saying that you take no more than 70 filters, okay, and take the filters of size 5 by 5. Even those can be treated as hyperparameters. You can try it. So that is not the thing. The point is that I know what's a cat, I know what's a dog, I know what's. But just imagine that we are starting investigations of something which we really don't know anything about, right? So then I don't know that there are 7 classes there. There could be any number of classes, slightly different from each other, right? So now 2 classes can be recognized if your resolution is good enough in some abstract way. If it is not good enough, even though there are 2 classes, I can't recognize them. So the thing that you could do in such circumstances is to try unsupervised learning. What happens in unsupervised learning is that you just tell it that, all right, you classify this. Okay, let's classify it into 20 classes. Then it will, it looks for aggregates. Just imagine that you've got a multidimensional space, right? And then look at it this way. Imagine 3-dimensional space in which there is a plane, right? There's a plane in 3-dimensional space. If I look at the plane from the edge, I'll see a straight line. But if I look at it from the top, I'll see the points which are spread. Right? So then there are different points of view in which you can look at it. So now there may be, it may be that, so you see that these points, if I look at them from the top, they'll see completely scattered. When you look at it from the edge, it's in a straight line. So what you can do is that you can take this multidimensional space, and then you can see whether in some way of looking at it, these are grouped together. Right, so that way I isolate the groups and study them. So they can be supervised and semi-supervised. But I will give you an example of that in a different thing. Okay. So I'll run through this pretty quickly now and go to the next one, that other example, because it brings in completely new concepts. So you see that this is a galaxy. Now, this is the galaxy, you've got the bulge, you've got the disk, and you've got the spiral arms. So if you look at these galaxies, you find that they also have these arms, etc. But each one of them has got this linear structure, which is known as a bar. And then these bars are very important, because they are found in about half the galaxies or more. And then they could be produced because of internal dynamics, and they could be produced because of external perturbations. And then once you've got a bar, matter can flow through the bar. Matter meaning what? Gas can flow, dust can flow, stars can flow through the bar. And then that changes the nature of the galaxy. So these bars are not, like somebody said, they're not just the icing on the cake. Okay, it is. It actually has got important properties which you need to understand. Right, so you see that this galaxy has no bar, this galaxy has, these have bars. So if I look at a lot of galaxies like this, some of them have bars, some of them don't have bars. So what we tried out a thing where, so what is the problem which we want to solve? Is that if I give you a sample of 20 million galaxies, can I say how many of them have bars and how many of them don't have bars? Or this galaxy has bar, 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 no bar, no bar, no bar. Right, so how do we do that? It's conceptually extremely simple. That we take a few thousand galaxies which have bars and a few thousand galaxies which have no bars. We need 30, 40,000 galaxies actually. We have got only a few thousand because that's the state of the art. And then we augment that sample by using rotated images and so on, which is a completely technical matter. I can tell you about that later. And then we train a network. This is the work I showed you. The work was done by Shilu Abraham and a group of people. And then you see that when the training is done, so what we do, we take these galaxies which are bar, galaxies which are no bar, and then train it with that, and then we take another large group of galaxies. Sorry. I think I'm getting a, I might be getting a call from Air India. So if you can talk to them, thank you. They lost my bag. It is very simple. They're not properly trained. So the bag was loaded in Pune and it didn't get off in Hyderabad. Okay. This is an extremely difficult thing to do. And to lose a bag in such a short journey and so well-defined journey. All right, so so you see that after the training is done, we test it. And then what do we find? You get what is known as a confusion matrix. It's actually called a deconfusion matrix because it removes the confusion. And what you do is that here, you see that we start with a certain number of barred galaxies, right? And then how many of those are classified as barred? 1100. And barred galaxies classified as unbarred is 173. And so this is the sum of the galaxies. So I've taken 1,273 barred galaxies. And then we asked the trained deep CNN to actually tell me how many are barred, and I get 1,100 correct. Right? And then if I unbarred galaxies, I get 2,568 correct out of this sum. So you see that it's extremely good performance. So what it means is that the precision is 86%. What does that, what does the precision there mean? Is that If it tells me 100 galaxies are barred, 86 of those would be really barred galaxies, meaning that I'm correct 86% of the time, right? And then the recall is 95%. Okay, meaning that if I take a 100 galaxies, then how many can I actually, I'll end up correctly classifying 95 galaxies. All right, so now let me move to the next one, 10 minutes. Spectral classification, yeah?
So, let's say you are going on both, like, that was done on 4,000 galaxies.
Yes.
So, if, how many do you need to actually test on it so that you become confident around 4,000 will give you such a good result?
Yeah. You see that these are all, again, very obvious but very important questions. And the way you deal with it, you see that you are always, you are hampered by the lack of data. Right? So then if I got 5,000 galaxies which I'm using in training, then am I going to keep it 2,500 to train and test? Right? If I do that, then I'm losing 2,500 for the training. So I say 4,000, 1,000. But is the 1,000 good enough? So then you can do all kinds of tests there. What you can do is that first you can take these 4,000 in the training and those 1,000 in testing. And then you can change that and do it. And then you average over it. So there are many different ways in which you can test these things out. Okay? So if I look at a star like the sun, then it's hot inside and cold outside. Cold meaning it is 6,000 degrees. It's hot enough to melt everything on Earth. And then 20 million Kelvin inside. And the radiation goes from the outside to the inside. So when I look at the face of the sun, yellow in color, what I'm doing is that I'm just looking at the photosphere of the sun, a layer which is only about 50 kilometers in size. Okay, and then that can be treated as a black body. Okay, meaning that when I look at it, some of you at least must be knowing what is black body radiation, is that it's an idealized body which would absorb all the radiation falling on it. Okay, and so when it also emits radiation, because it goes on absorbing radiation, the temperature goes up and it emits radiation, that radiation has got a very simple thing. So if the temperature of the body is 10,000 Kelvin, so this will be the spectrum of the body. Right, and this is called black body radiation. As the temperature decreases, the peak goes to higher wavelengths. Now this has been known since the 1850s, the spectrum. And people try to say what it is and to derive the formula. They couldn't derive it. And then in exactly 1900, in the middle of 1900, Max Planck, okay, he actually got the formula. Okay, he derived, and then for that he had to introduce the concept of the quantum. There's a famous professor called Professor Mukunda in Bangalore, and he has written a beautiful book on the story of the quantum mechanics, in which he has said that Max Planck had gone to his friend's place for dinner, for lunch, and they started talking about the black body radiation. And when he came home, he got the idea and he did it. And he introduced the idea of the quantum for that. So I didn't need all this. Now when you actually look at the spectrum of the sun, when I look at it, it's yellow in color. So I know from black body physics the temperature is about 6,000 Kelvin. But then what I do is that, then Newton did it for the first time, pass it through a prism. And then what do? You get this 7 colors. But if you look at it with sufficient resolution, then you see these dark lines here on it. You see the dark lines on it? And these are called the Fraunhofer lines. So what are the dark lines? The hot radiation from the inside is going outside. Inside, everything is completely ionized. There are nuclei and there are free electrons. But as you go outwards, the ionization is not complete. And that is because the temperature has become lower. Right? So a beam of light going can be intercepted by an atom, raises an electron to a higher level, and that much radiation gets absorbed. Okay, and then it is rescattered in all directions. The net result is that because you're removing that photon, you get a dark line. The spread of the dark lines, they depend upon, first of all, what is the chemical composition, how much nitrogen, how much oxygen, and so on. Depend on chemical composition, and it depends upon the parameters of the gas, the thermodynamic parameters of the gas, okay, meaning what's the temperature, what's the pressure, and so forth. That theory is fully developed now. Right, so you've got this spectrum. So when I look at it, now this is a digital version of this one, and this is the approximate black body curve. No problem. When you look at stars, you can get many different spectra. So there are a lot of women worked on this in the beginning of the 20th century in Harvard. And then they have learned how to photograph the spectra of stars. Okay, so you've got all these photographs, and they're not beautiful things like this. They're just black and white smudges. And these women were very patient. They went on looking at them. And they said that it is not as if the spectrum of every star is different. It falls into different categories. And then they gave those categories arbitrary names. God knows what they were dictated by. But currently, you can categorize these spectra with mainly with 7 letters, and each one of them, O, B, A, F, and so forth, and each one of them has got 10 further classes. So 7 into 10, and that is 70. And then each such class, subclass, can have 5 different luminosity classes. What do you mean by luminosity classes? I'll show that to you here. You see that this is known as a very famous diagram in astronomy, which is called the Hertzsprung-Russell diagram. And here you've got the temperature of the stars, and here you've got the luminosity. And then you see that most stars on this is known as the main sequence. Right? So you see, whereas here, these stars have the same temperature, but they are very much larger, and they are called the giants. So you see that, you see the spectral type there? So there's a correlation between the spectral type and the temperature, and spectral type and luminosity. So the idea is that if I can look at the spectrum and say what spectral type it is, right, then I know I have a lot of information about it. I'll just finish in 5 minutes. Yeah. Right, so then if I show you, then I get a lot of information about the stars. And much of modern astrophysics was developed out of the spectral classification. Right, so but then what is the problem in the current time? So we wrote recently a paper on it, and it was put on the website. And within a couple of hours, we got an email from a very senior German astrophysicist, whom I have known well in the past. So he said that, look, I read this paper, and it has made me very happy, because I got a lot of data, spectral data on stars. So how do they get a lot of spectral data? There's a giant instrument called MUSE. And MUSE is a multi-fiber spectrograph. It is what is called an integral flux unit. What you can do is that you point to a part of the sky, and then let us suppose that you have got a thing like a globular cluster with many, many stars. Then you put those fibers. And each star, each fiber is on one star. And in one blast, one observation, you can get spectra of hundreds of stars. Right? So this guy says, he's a very senior person who hundreds of people reporting to him. He's one of the PIs of the MUSE instrument. And he says that, look, I have very painfully classified these 450 stars. Personally, I won't be able to do it. But you guys know how to apply deep learning to do it. So why don't we do it together? So this is a practical thing, is that even though people have already classified many, many stars, you may get new data where you want immediate classification. Right? Because depending upon what class it is, I can take different actions, right? Or I can get different physics out of it. So how do we do this then? I won't go into the details. We have got the training samples, meaning that we have got a few thousand spectra which are already classified. Meaning the experts are told us this is star O6, this is K5, whatever. It's classified. And then we want to use it with, people have used machine learning networks with it for many years. For 2 decades they have been doing it. And then they have got a certain accuracy with the machine learning network, and they have done that. So the question is, can I use deep learning networks to do this better? Faster, better, with greater, better meaning what? That with greater accuracy. And perhaps even recognize what? Our main problem is not to just carry on the boring task of classification, but by doing it to a very large number of stars, isolate those which cannot be classified. And those would be the outliers, those would be the interesting objects. So what do we do here? We use a completely different kind of thing known as an autoencoder. So what an autoencoder does, let me see if I got a thing here. So here, the input, though it is shown as the image here, the input is the spectrum. So you give it a spectrum, the autoencoder, just like the CNN, it studies the thing. And then what it does is that it goes on coding it, meaning reducing the dimensionality of the spectrum of the data until it is completely coded. And then the whole thing is put in the reverse direction so that it goes on decoding it and is fully decoded. And what do you finally have? I've given it a spectrum, coding, decoding. And in the ideal case, I should get back exactly the same spectrum. And then you go on adjusting the weights until you do that. So now the question is, why do you want to do it? Why am I so happy if I match input and output? Because then I can take 1,000 spectra and pass it through that, right? And then it cannot ideally reproduce every spectrum. because it's got a finite number of weights. Infinite number of weights, it can reproduce infinite number of spectra. And then it idealizes it so that it does it as well as it can. And then once it has done that, it has learned how to handle spectra. Then you remove this and replace it with a classification unit, and then you classify the stars. Right? So what is the thing, interesting thing here? It is neither unsupervised nor is it supervised, but it is semi-supervised, meaning that you are not telling it what the spectra are in the beginning, right? But it learns how to classify it. And then you give it, then it is the next step, it is supervised learning, because I'm then giving it spectra where I know the labels. So we did that, and we get very good results here, because this is the expected class and this is the correct class. It's lying on the straight line, and you can actually, there are different ways in which you can do it, and you find that you get an accuracy of 1 point, how much, Kaushal, 1.1 or 1.2? What's the best accuracy we got? 1.1 subclass. Yeah. And so then 1.1 sub. What does it mean? Is that if the subclass is supposed to be 68, then sometimes we'll get 67, sometimes 65, sometimes 69. But the average displacement is only about 1.1 subclass. Right? So I'll stop there. Thank you. There were very good questions along the way, but there should be some more now.
Anybody? Any questions? All right. Thank you so much, sir. It was wonderful having you here. Thank you so much for taking your time. And thank you. Possibly we can go to my office. Yeah? And I would like to have a word with you guys. Thank you. So immediately in another 10 minutes, tea will be served. And for next 10 minutes, I would like to have a quick session. Yeah.